We present Speedy Death by Gladys Mitchell, dramatized for radio by Elizabeth Proud, with Mary Wimbush as Mrs. Lestrange Bradley, Leslie Phillips as Carstairs, and Michael Cochran as Bertie Phillipson. Speedy Death.
I know what I know, and I deduce what I deduce. I am a psychologist, not a policewoman. Accusation is not my business, nor is storytelling. Mr. Carstairs would be a better choice for that. He enjoyed the confidence of the police.
Well, it's true that as an entomologist, I've had some experience of detective work. It's also true that of all the people involved in this extraordinary affair, I alone was never under suspicion. Not even Mrs. Bradley suspected me.
True, my friend. Continue.
It was the August of 1929. Several of us were staying at Janings, Alistair Bing's country house. I'd known Bing a long time. He called himself an archaeologist, though in fact it was only a rich man's hobby. He was a widower, and his unmarried daughter, Eleanor, ran the house. His son, Guard, was a medical student. The story starts on Tuesday the 13th, with young Guard Bing waiting at the railway station for his fiancée. One of the guests, Bertie Phillipson, was with him.
There she is, Guard! Dorothy! Over here!
And about time, too. Dorothy!
Hello, Guard, darling. Hello, Bertie. I didn't expect to see you.
Come along, Dorothy, for goodness sake. It's nearly 6:30. The house is full of awful people, and dinner's at 7:30, of all ungodly hours.
Dashed early. But you know what old Bing's like.
It's very nice to see you again, Bertie. What have you been doing with yourself?
Oh, I've been out and about, you know.
As I got to know Phillipson, I came to realise that he wasn't at all the silly ass he seemed to be. He was older than he seemed, too. He'd fought in Flanders in the Great War. Had quite a beastly time, I suspect, though he never spoke of it. He'd known Dorothy well for some time, and I think was in love with her.
Still the little lounge lizard, Bertie. Why don't you get yourself something to do?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, not much point, is there? Of course, if you... Well, if things have been different...
Oh, Bertie, I'm sorry. I do like you ever so much, but with Guard, it's different. There's something about him.
Yes, there is. His size and his beastly temper. You'll have to be a good kid when you're married.
I know. You can't think how exciting it is to be scared stiff of your future husband.
What are you saying about me, woman?
Darling, nothing. Do be careful. I'm sure the driver ought not to take notice of what the people behind are saying. Now, Bertie, tell me about all the guests at Chaining's. Is there anyone I know?
Let me see. Do you know a fellow called Mountjoy?
The explorer? I've heard of him. A large, hairy, loud-voiced, primitive sort of creature, with a big black beard.
Oh, rot! He's a little, slim, clean-shaven, shy sort of fellow. In fact, the only person who seems to be able to get two words out of him is, well, who do you think?
Not Eleanor.
Eleanor it is. In fact, she's engaged to the fellow. Unofficially, of course.
Pull yourself together, Bertie. I've never seen anything so wildly improbable as Eleanor's behaviour with men. You'd never think she was Guard's sister.
Then there's Mrs. Bradley. Know her? Little, old, shriveled, clever, sarcastic sort of dame. I believe she's a witch. Good old sport, though. Friend of yours, isn't she, Guard? Didn't she get you out of a rather nasty scrape on boat race night
That's
with
her? That's enough, Bertie.
Whoops! Sorry, old man. Enough said.
Nobody quite knew who she was or why she had been invited. When I asked her later, she only laughed.
Then there's a chap named Carstairs. Very decent, scientific sort of bloke. Beatles or something. And that's the lot, apart from your future power-in-law.
Still as bad-tempered as ever, I suppose.
Oh, well, Bing's not so bad if you don't see too much of him. He can't stand Mrs. Bradley, by the way. But he gets on famously with Carstairs and the Mountjoy chappie.
Mountjoy? Mountjoy, the fella's an ass. Oh,
he's certainly very late for dinner.
Do you know, Carstairs, this very afternoon, that nincompoop, that Everard Mountjoy, stated as his considered an expert opinion that the mound on Beldon Down isn't an ancient British earthwork, but the remains of a bunker on the old golf course.
Oh, really? Oh.
Ridiculous fella. What a clown.
Begging your pardon, sir.
Well, what is it, Mabel? Cobb.
If you please, sir, Parson says that Mr. Mountjoy went to take his bath upwards of an hour ago and has not reappeared.
Reappeared? What do you mean, reappeared? Fella isn't a disembodied spirit, is he? Tell Parsons to go and knock at the bathroom door. Ridiculous fella.
What are you waiting for, Cobb?
If you please, Miss Eleanor, Parsons has hammered and hammered at the bathroom door and there's no answer. We think the gentleman must have been taken ill.
Nonsense, nonsense. Rubbish, rubbish, rubbish.
I remember that a friend of mine fainted in the bath some 4 years ago. She drowned.
I say.
Oh, really?
Mrs. Bradley, how terrible.
I think I'll go and see if there's anything wrong.
Yes, indeed. I'll come with you, guard.
Oh, very well. But the whole thing's ridiculous.
I say, Eleanor, do you think I should go too?
No, Bertie, of course not. I expect it's all a false alarm. If you're not going to eat any more, Dorothy, the girl can remove the plates. Cobb!
Guard's legs were longer than mine. By the time I reached the upstairs landing, he was already subjecting the bathroom door to a vigorous hammering.
I must have fainted. Vote we break in.
Half a moment. We might as well try the handle first.
Fine.
Good heavens! It wasn't locked!
Well, I'm damned. It's a woman. I say, she's dead.
A doctor. A doctor. I'll telephone. Where the devil is Mountjoy, though?
There's no doubt she's dead.
No doubt about it. I've studied enough medicine to be sure of that. It's a weird business, isn't it? What the devil was she doing, having a bath in our house? Who is she? How did she get in? And a devil of a lot of other things.
Such as?
Such as the bathroom window being wide open, top and bottom, and the door being unlocked. And where's that chap Mountjoy?
There. Dead.
What did you say?
I know it's a shock, but we have to face it. That woman is Mountjoy, all right. And I shouldn't tell your sister.
Tell Eleanor? But she'll have to know.
About the death of Mountjoy, yes. The fact that Mountjoy was a woman, no.
Yes, I get you. Rather bad luck to find out that the chap you're engaged to is a woman. What?
Guard, stop being a fool.
It was no use. I'm afraid young Bing made a poor fist of breaking the news to his sister.
He's dead.
Huh? Who?
Why, Mountjoy, of course. That's why he didn't come down to dinner. He couldn't. He was drowned in the bath.
God, what do you mean?
I mean that Mountjoy is dead, as a doormat.
But look here.
Well, I can't stop. Doctor will be here any minute. Not that he can do anything. Poor fella. Dead as a door now.
Well, I think we might repair to the drawing room now.
According to Bertie, even Mrs. Bradley looked astonished at that. Next morning, I came upon that redoubtable woman talking to Bertie on the veranda.
Good morning, Mr. Carstairs. You are just in time for a serious intellectual discussion.
Oh?
Yes. And Mr. Phillips in here thinks that an accident took place in this house last night.
Oh?
Now, I think it was a suicide.
Oh. I can trust you two people not to act idiotically if I tell you something very unpleasant, I suppose.
Oh, certainly.
Of course. There was murder committed in this house last evening.
Ah. Fancy that.
What do you say, Carstairs? I say murder. Carefully planned, deliberately executed murder. First, there is the queer fact that although a man known to the scientists of two continents as Everard Mountjoy went into that bathroom, we found an unknown woman drowned there, and no trace of Mountjoy except his dressing gown.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.